out here, and I met that gal from Haywarden at a wedding, my brother's wedding, and came out here a couple times, didn't. Thank God I married somebody else, but don't record that. But, you know, I just really got taken in with just the down home. I don't even like to use the word down home. Just people out here don't have airs. They don't have, you know, I can just tell when you make eye contact with some people, they're just straight shooters, and they believed in family, and they believe in, you know, faith is a big part of how they define themselves. And so when I graduated from law school, I decided to move to Sioux City. So that's what brought me to Northwest Iowa 30 years ago. And I made the right choice. I married to a terrific lady. She was my first client as a lawyer. I did her divorce. She was my very first client. And when her divorce was over, she and I had dinner with her three kids almost every night for 3 years. And I just said, well, I never envisioned marrying somebody with three kids. But this lady, her husband cheated on her. Probably don't need to say that either. She ended up being like the nicest lady, so we ended up getting married 3 years later. And we've been married 25 years, and I have three grandkids. This is just a little background about me. But it was the best decision I ever made. I miss the ocean, but I don't miss this, you know, the traffic and the culture of the East Coast is really different than here, and I love living here. I love being an Iowan. I am an Iowan. You know, I'm often asked, why are you doing this? So it looks like pretty much everybody here in this room is probably old enough to have grandkids, or at the very least kids. And the question that I always comes to mind for me is, are our children and our grandchildren going to be free? And I think we have real reason to doubt that right now, because it just seems like every time we turn around, there's some new power grab, there's some new justification to take away a piece of how we define ourselves as free people. And if you look at the path that it's taken, it's either fairness or it's a crisis, and there's always some justification. There's been an existential assault on freedom like we've never seen before. I mean, for me, this last election spoke to that, because there was evidence of fraud. We all know that. It was there. I mean, yeah, I'm a math guy. I actually look at statistics and statistical probabilities. Sometimes as a lawyer, I present the numbers to the jury and I'll say, well, this guy's saying this and these are his numbers. Do those numbers make sense to you? They don't make sense to me either. So when we look at statistical anomalies, and I actually talked to a guy the other day who invented barcodes. He invented all the barcodes that you see in a grocery store. And this guy's like one of those, he's a genius. But almost all those transactions this guy invented, and he said there was unequivocally fraud in the selection. And I can take you through it and tell you why. So we know what happened. It never got looked at. Because it never got looked at, how bad it was never defined. Because it was never defined, we don't know where the leaks are, and no real actions were taken to correct it. And I think we've incentivized future fraud. So, like, we're not calling the shots anymore. We're not deciding who gets elected anymore if this stuff gets worse. I think we did a decent job in Iowa because we're always working on voter ID stuff. And, you know, we got told, you know, you guys are terrible, you're suppressing the vote. Fraud is voter suppression. If Pennsylvania can decide the outcome of an election by having no way of authenticating voters, then we have a real problem. And like, That's going to have to be taken up. Their answer for that, Democrats' answer for that, is to facilitate more voter fraud. So why didn't that get looked at? Okay? That's the question you have to ask yourself. Why was this not looked at? Why didn't this get a real look? And you know what? You can probably figure it out. Because the process is not what we think it is in some respects. Your voice isn't being heard. And I can tell you, one of the realities of the process is the people that write the checks tend to get hurt. You know, the forgotten man, middle class people that are in this endless assault of taxes and increased health care costs. You know, people think this, like this $1.9 trillion he's talking about right now, okay? That is a huge tax increase for the middle class. Because that money isn't going to help people. Small percentage of it, I don't know, what are they saying now, $1,400?
19% or 9% of the whole bill.
Where's the other 91% going and who's paying for it?
Communist countries.
Well,
Democratic payback.
It is.
So, like, the point is, that other 91% is money we don't have that we're borrowing.
From China. The...
We're printing money. But that's
a tax increase.
Yeah, it is.
Because now, your money is worth less and less. It's worth less and less. So, the inflation from something like that will represent like a 10 to 15% devaluation of every dollar you make, which means for you and me, it's a tax increase. So, you know, so you have to look at, you know, like, you know, you mentioned China. Our manufacturing base has been shipped over to China since the 1990s. It's gone. So they, you know, the political class watched this happen. They watched it happen. Trump is the first guy to say, whoa. Our entire manufacturing base has been shipped overseas so corporations can take advantage of cheap labor, and we give tax credits to corporations that do that. We cannot allow that to go on. We found out that we don't manufacture any prescription drugs, and we need them. I mean, we need to learn from this. We need to do just what President Trump was doing and incentivize our manufacturing capacity again in the United States. He did a lot of things. You know, China right now, they're manipulating their currency at a loss to run up huge trade deficits. In 1986, it was $6 billion. Do you know what it is today? It's $680 billion a year. That's the trade deficit. So almost, you know, north of a half trillion a year is being shipped to China. And, you know, so what does that represent in real numbers? We're talking about 500,000 jobs a year going to China. Because our economy is diminished by that percentage of money that's making its way to China. You know, if you look at a gross domestic product, what does $680 billion represent? Well, when we lose $680 billion in gross domestic product, that affects all of us. That affects what we can pay in manufacturing jobs. That affects our entire economy. So, you know, you can't overlook that because their economy is actually weaponized. It's designed to do everything they can to take us down. That's like, so like the point of this is they're at war with us economically. All right? Now, you can't look at that any other way. This is a country that has a surveillance state of their own people, that have a million of the Uyghurs in concentration camps. That's what you're dealing with. Okay? They've shipped products to our country that weren't safe, and they knew it. There was a deal where people were dying from some of the chemicals in their products, and, you know. And just the whole way they try to manipulate and dominate the entire world economic stage. If they're treating us like we're at war with them, we're going to have to respond to that in a meaningful way. You know, like the rest of the world has to wake up. We have to wake up. And you know, when Reagan dealt with Russia in the 80s, he called it what it was. He said, you're an evil empire. Why did he do that? He just said, well, let's let this be defined by reality. You're an evil empire. Okay? If Reagan were alive today, he would look at China right in the eye and say, you're an evil empire. We got to deal with you. We have to deal with it. We have to put together a NATO-like coalition that says on trade, you're going to deal fairly with us. Or you know what we're going to do? We're going to start cutting you out of the game of our economies incrementally, because that's the only thing they understand. We don't have any meaningful deterrent or threat to them. President Trump was the first person to confront them. There's a book out that you guys might be interested in. It's called Death by China. I strongly encourage you to read it, because the realities of what's going on is it's really vivid. And it would concern anybody. And the problem is, when all this was going on, these corporations that shipped their manufacturing base over there, they gave money to the campaigns of the political class to look the other way. Well, now we're having to live with the reality of that. You know, unfortunately, the process rewards corruption. That's just the reality. You got to have a strong backbone to say, I'm not making deals with my conscience for you or for anybody. You know, this life is pretty darn short, and then you're gonna live out, you're going to eat the sandwich you made, good or bad, for others with your life and your decisions and what you decided to do. And I believe there is a God in heaven, and I believe each one of us is going to have our story told before him. And that's real to me.
Amen.
So
accountability.
Well, if you want to talk about accountability, was anybody held accountable for the election fraud?
Not yet.
Okay. If you want to talk about accountability, was anybody held in the 2008 banking mortgage crisis? Anybody go to jail?
No.
Was Hillary Clinton held accountable for 30,000 emails?
No.
Benghazi.
Was she held accountable?
Americans?
No. So, I mean, that's the problem, because if nobody's held accountable, you can be pretty sure that there's a component of tyranny running the process that doesn't care one bit about the rule of law. There's a different set of rules for the political class than there is for the people of the country.
You better correct that. For the Democratic Party, the Republican Party, they're out to get them every time. Look what they did to Trump.
Right.
Well, I mean, when you look at what happened to Trump, because when you look at what happened to Trump, how many Republicans sided with him publicly? I will.
Deep in, that's about it.
Because, like, you know, he just went through a four-year bar fight where he put his life on the line, literally, got attacked like nobody else, was threatened with impeachment before he even got sworn in, and he took it on the chin for every single one of us. And, you know, like, if you want to locate somebody in a friendship, in a relationship, you look at the sacrifice they're making. To be subjected to that day in and day out, take it on the chin, and to just fight those people with a courage. I mean, he showed real courage, the kind of which we've never seen in a politician since I believe Reagan. I think Reagan had a lot of guts. But, you know, he stood up for us. And the other thing is he brought to light a lot of things. So, You know, part of the reason why I want to run is you have to deal with corruption if you're going to be free. You have to deal with it. There has to be accountability. And you can't shut up, because passivity is the same thing as affirming evil. If you don't do anything, you may as well be validating the thing you're complaining about. You have to get on the field of the conversation. You know, some of the other things that just the last 20 years, look at the institution of the family. Just like if you were to consider the health of a country as being different, how healthy are our families now? Do they have a mom and dad that are committed for life, kids that grow up in a safe home? The love and care of a mother and father. So right now you have wrong-headed government tax policies and welfare things that take away the very thing a child needs to be successful, a mother and a father, where you grow up, where discipline and accountability are expected of you. It's way, way different now. You know, the whole commitment to marriage. Well, if you want to know how real you are, it's how committed you are to the people in your life. You know, we have to do something in policy and legislation that rewards two-parent families instead of punishes them. The welfare system is almost designed to create single-parent poverty. You can't have that. Yeah, you have to take a look at that. Choice in education. If you're a kid, and this is a bill I ran last year in the State House. If your child's in a failing school, they should have an alternative. And a failing school means one out of three kids doesn't graduate. One out of three kids do not graduate from a failing school. I wrote a bill last year that the governor submitted this year. It says, if your child is in a failing school, they get an education savings account. They can enroll their child in a private school or a charter school as an alternative. If your school has one in three children failing, flunking out, that means that they've made peace with failure, that dropping out is part of the culture of the place. You do not want your kid in a culture that accepts dropping out as being the norm. Because kids pick up on the culture of the place. And I gotta say, there's a lot of public schools that do a fantastic job. A lot of the Catholic schools and the Christian schools do a fantastic job. They raise the bar of expectation on these kids, and good things happen. They get a good education. Their proficiency scores go up. So what I wanted to do is, let's get them that private option. And after they get the private option, let's take a look at the numbers for proficiency. And if the numbers are better, I've made my point, because the best interest of the kids should be what define it. Another thing that has happened in the last 30, 40 years, the decline of rural America. We've seen it. It was because of the manufacturing base. But, you know, right now, 5G and broadband are like electricity was 100 years ago. You can use 5G on your farms, on your equipment. If you're going to incentivize having people live here instead of the younger generation all wanting to move to the city, which is what's going on, you have to make your communities attractive options. I came up with a telemedicine bill when I was in the House for a first year, which would say you could put a telemedicine platform on Main Street small town Iowa, so like a pregnant woman could get OBG checkups, you know, like a urine draw, blood draw, those kinds of things, so she can get some healthcare component in small towns. And farmers, you are terrible about getting into the doctor's office generally. Why? You don't want to get in the car and drive 40 miles because you're too busy working on other stuff, right? But if you could just go down to Main Street, get your blood pressure taken, get your blood drawn, get it submitted, see that cardiologist on that screen, It'll save you a lot of time, make it a lot easier for you. And then if you needed a follow-up, you know, we have to make those kinds of things available. Right next door, you could have a telepharmacy to that. So you got two new storefronts on Main Street, and you have to take care of childcare. You have to have, you know, some childcare has to be made available to keep our young people here in a good school system. We're going to have to get rid of the death tax, or we're going to have to up the number. I was talking to a good friend of mine. When you guys pass your farm to the kids, you know, that first $11.5 million, is it? I know Biden wants to lower that number. If he lowers that number, so $11.5 million is what, 115 acres about? So if you have a farm worth more than, you know, if you have more than 115 acres, 45% of that's going to taxes. How do you transfer the family farm under those circumstances? What can you do to deal with that? The family farm, you know, like if you've kept the farm alive the last 100 years, you've probably been threatened by bankruptcy a number of times, right? You can't do that to farmers. Farmers are the backbone of the economy of the country. We have to keep them alive. We have to keep the family farm alive. You can't punish them by taking 45% of what they earn when they die so that they have to sell almost half of what they had to pay those taxes. That's not acceptable. And they know it. And it, you know, I think Trump raised it from, what, $3.5 million to $11.5 million? Does anybody know that? Is that about right? You know, we should try to either raise it to 15.
About eliminated.
Or eliminated. But, you know, here's the thing.
It's been taxed and paid for how many times?
But here's the thing. You want to be able to deliver on what you say. I don't want to just say, I think eliminating the death tax is absolutely necessary. But I'm not going to, you know, like, I learned in Des Moines, it took me 3.5, 4 years to get anything done. I wanted a senior property tax freeze for fixed income seniors. I introduced that my first year in the House. It's going to get done this year in the Senate. And I hope that the House will agree to that. So if you make $30,000 a year or less, your property taxes don't go up at age 65 and beyond. Okay? That's what I came up with. I don't know if they're going to go with a 65 number, but the point is, you have to keep working the process to help people. You know, another big issue is big tech suppression. You know, the President of the United States had his free speech shut down. Literally shut down. When Twitter said, nope, you're done. Facebook said, nope, you're off. Amazon took Parler's platform from them. We're gonna have to pursue some meaningful antitrust legislation against these guys. They should not be able to control. Right now, Google is used 90% of the time from a desktop, 75% of the time from a phone. Have you guys ever noticed the difference between a Google search and a DuckDuckGo search? It's huge, because they have algorithms to define content. And why do they want to do that? Because if I can control the content, I can control the conversation, the culture, the way you think, which means what you believe, which means your whole perception. Like I've learned sometimes I just need to lay off the media so I don't get too negative. You know, just lay off the media. And, you know, define the way you think the way you want to. Like, that's an enormous amount of power over our kids. They're completely oblivious to the fact there was an intelligence warfare expert who said that the internet is now weaponized against young people, and they have no idea. They have no idea that is going on. So we're going to have to deal with that. We're going to have to deal with censorship. The last thing I want to say, thank thanks for patiently listening to all this. I appreciate it. I want to commend President Trump for being the first president to meaningfully confront China's weaponized trade practices in a real way. He's the first person to really bring meaningful peace to the Middle East. I've never seen any president do what he's done in the Middle East. He got a $6,000 increase in income for the middle class. And he did the right thing with Iran, the Iran nuclear deal. I mean, who on earth gives $150 billion to the world's leading sponsor of terror?
Obama.
Global elitist.
Well, you know, it's like, why would you do that? And the other thing is, with his selection of Supreme Court nominees, he picked people that would stand up for the Constitution, which means stand up for freedom. We'll see how that all plays out. I'm not too impressed so far with what's happened, but on his end, he did the right thing. And like the last thing I want you to think about is, you know, will my grandchildren be free? That's the question of our generation and the responsibility. You know, like as you live out your daily life, you have to internalize their freedom as your responsibility. Like, this is your responsibility. And you have to get involved in any way that you can. If you don't make their freedom personal to you, you're going to passively watch it happen. President Trump didn't do that. He wasn't the least bit passive. He stood up like a man and he dealt with it for all of us. Nothing less is required of us. We have to do everything we can to give them what was given to us. You know, right outside this building, what does it say? Freedom isn't free, right? Freedom isn't free. The price of freedom is sacrifice and responsibility, and we all have to pay for it to keep it for our children. So, thanks for being here today. I don't claim to be an expert on a lot of things, but if you guys have any questions, I'd be glad to take them.
Steve King, how would you have handled that?
With what? With what happened to him? Or?
Yes, and how our senators and governor handled it.
Okay.
Explain what you're trying to say there.
If I explain it, it'll
I pushed for the heartbeat bill. That was Steve King's bill. Okay. And when I say pushed, I mean myself and three other legislators, Senator Zahn, Senator Chapman, and I actually went to Rick Bertrand of Sioux City, and I said, Rick, how do we get the heartbeat bill passed? He said, if there's four of us, we can put enough pressure on leadership by withholding votes to make that heartbeat bill get to the floor. It got to the floor and it got passed. 17 other states copied it. And the origin of that heartbeat bill was Steve King. Okay. That was his bill. All right. You know, he's been called a racist, but he was instrumental in helping African children. You know. So, I mean, you can accuse people of a bunch of things. But what did he do? Okay? Like, what did he do? Okay? He stood up for African children and did everything he could to facilitate taking care of them when they're on the ground here. Or actually, I think it was Steve Meyer and the CNOS people had to do some work. He had to do some work behind the scenes. So, it's what you do that defines you. I hope that answers your question. But it really, it's what you do that defines you, not what the New York Times says about you.
Right. I think you're answering. My point is that I feel both of our senators and even our governor basically threw him under the bus and wouldn't defend him.
That's right.
All it had to do was say, yeah, maybe Steve could have said a little bit differently,
can't speak to what they did. I can only speak to what I did and what I've said. And I haven't gone on record before that question's been asked of me, because it hasn't been asked of me. I think he was unfairly characterized by that whole thing. I don't personally know him to be a racist at all. I don't believe he is. But the way he handled it, I think if he got to do it over again, and the way he addressed it might be a little bit different.
I have a question.
Sure.
Do you know, did they pass a bill in the state of Iowa last week over this election fraud, the bill that would protect us for midterm in 2024, as far as how you cast ballots, how the ballots be handled, anything? I mean, can you fill us in on that? Because
sure.
I heard they did, but I don't know what the details are, and I think it's really important. It's important to you, specifically,
sure.
At midterm. Is there even a chance of a free and fair election going forward? Or, I mean, if we don't pass the right policy now, we're going to be in the same boat as we were in January with that election, the 2021 election. So what we really need to know, I mean, what was the bill, what can we do, how do we stop it, how do we avoid the election, not just in the state of Iowa, but on a national. And how would you deal with that should you get in? How would you be able to push that all the way through to make it happen for us?
I mean, the reason why the process ended up the way it ended up was there's different rules on eligibility from every state. One state says your ballot counts 2 weeks after the election. One state says there has to be postmarks, one doesn't. One state says if you want an absentee ballot, you have to have an excuse. Another doesn't. One state says there has to be signature verification. One state doesn't. Pennsylvania, like within the months leading up to the election, got rid of signature verification, postmarks, and they extended the deadline, I believe, 2 weeks past the election. That's a huge battleground state. One state, particularly a battleground state, should not be able to define the outcome of the whole country by making it way, way easier for voter fraud to take place, and I believe did. In my mind, there was leaks in the Dominion voting machines. That really needs to be looked at in a real way. You know, they're threatening people with billion-dollar lawsuits and everything else. Okay. All we want to do is know the truth. So, subpoena all the data to those secretaries of state, and let's take a real look at it. You know, it's kind of late in the game now to be looking at it. It should have been looked at. You know, we had between Election Day and January 6th. Why didn't we subpoena those records when we had the opportunity? We should have. Okay. There has to be some uniformity on voter ID. Okay. One of the concerns I have is with this HR1, I believe, they just like virtually got rid of every meaningful way to identify a voter, which basically means massive voter suppression of the real votes. You know, it's not giving more people an opportunity to vote. It's decimating the votes of the people that are eligible to vote. Right? So, that has to be redefined. I mean, this was a real wake-up call. This is how bad it is.
You could write policy like that.
I could. A lot of people believe that there was a lot of voter fraud. I'm one of them. Was it enough to overturn the election? I guess we won't know. I kind of think it was, but there was massive evidence of fraud that never got looked at. So it that could be done now. You know, I mean, there's very smart people out there who can look inside a machine and give you a whole bunch of information about what went on, and that really needs to be thoroughly investigated, even now. So,
well, if HR 1 does pass, does that supersede the state's voter laws then, or what recourse does it?
I think it would. And the Constitution says the states get to define their own election processes.
So what recourse does it?
Under the 14th Amendment, but I think it's okay for the state should be able to individually administer their elections, but there has to be some voter ID authentication that's defined nationally. And when I say identification, I mean identification. You know, like I visited Kenya five times. Do you know how you vote in Kenya? With your thumb. So if Kenya can say you vote with your thumb, why can't we?
Because it's beneficial to the Democrats.
Well, nobody else has your thumb, right? It'd be a bad way to do it.
There was a fellow, I don't know who I was listening to, either Hannity or Rush, before Rush passed, saying that they ought to declare Election Day holiday or whatever, and you go and vote. You don't vote, you don't get paid, but you come back and prove that you voted. Doesn't make any difference who, but so on. And there were several stipulations that he said, like you can't send out a bunch of ballots and so on to everybody, like some fellow down in Sioux City did.
Yeah. He pre-populated the ballots.
Yeah.
So your individual voter ID information was in the request, so anybody could turn it in. We caught him doing that.
Yeah, we should.
So,
but he's still in office.
He is.
Why?
We need to change that.
Why?
Because we just wrote a law this year on that very point. I didn't answer all of your questions.
That's what I thought.
So, but if you violate state laws as an auditor, you're going to be subject to a felony charge now because of what happened there. We are not going to have ballot harvesting. We banned ballot harvesting. Drop boxes, you're going to have one drop box per county, one location, and there's going to be security. So, you know, you're not going to have drop boxes everywhere with no security where there can be tampering. We close that loophole. I think we have more work to do besides, but Senator Robbie Smith has done a lot of really good work in the last few years on voter ID. And our process is probably one of the best in the country, and it's even going to be better, I believe. And so those are some of the things that were in this year's bill. You can't have pre-populated ballots. The number of days went from 29 to 20 before Election Day. I think 20 days is enough time. And that's not to disenfranchise people.
No, I think it's hopeful.
Yeah.
I think it's a hopeful statement. And Trump also said Election Day should be one day. You go down and vote unless you are, unless you have a reason that you can't, that
right.
You're sick or, you know, otherwise.
Or you have a disability.
Right, or disability. But, what we're the freest country in the nation. Why can't we all get together on, I think this is our opportune time to start writing bills, taking it seriously. I believe that the state of Iowa has always had that conversation on their platform and on the committee. They've always talked about voter fraud all the way down to the counties. It's always been kind of a topic. So I think that if we push the topic in the public and let them know that we're aware that there's a problem, that's a good starting point. And not be afraid to talk about it.
Yeah, honestly, the city process has really suffered because people are too afraid to say what they think. I ran a bathroom bill a couple weeks ago. I took a lot of heat for that, but I'm like, to me, women and little girls should not have to worry about a man coming into the restroom. That's the only reason I did it. You know, little kids in school should not be taught about gender identity when they're 4 years old. So I wrote a bill that says parents need to be notified and verbally consent to it. You can't be afraid of controversy to do the right thing. You know, you got to let the chips fall where they're gonna, and you just have to stand for something.
Also of concern in that HR 1 bill, isn't Puerto Rico?
Puerto Rico is another state.
Isn't that in that bill as well?
Yeah.
Can you address that and how that may affect what goes on in Washington?
Well, I mean, obviously, politically, there are implications for adding Puerto Rico as a state. I think that the motivation behind that is more about leveraging more position for the Democrats to win national elections. That's what it's about. It's about adding congressmen and senators to the process to give them more votes in the House, more votes in the Senate, and that's really what that's about.
So how do the Republicans, with that HR 1 bill, basically either douse it completely with water or trying to get a Puerto Rico deal out of there at least, so there isn't, and to me that's just unfair advantage.
It is.
It's not a level playing field anymore.
Right. And that's the point. So, there's always going to be negotiation in the process. There's always going to be, like the whole issue of the filibuster, are we still going to have one? I think the Democrats would probably love to get rid of the filibuster. Because right now,
this year,
the 60%, they don't want it to even be on the table. So,
what's the Puerto Rico vote going to be, majority or 60 senators?
I don't know.
Why not?
Because I know the Democrats well enough to know that they will do what they can to either get rid of the filibuster on that vote or overcome it. I think you can almost virtually guarantee people are going to get a real eyeful of their real agenda. We already are. I mean, right now at the border, there is no border. So, it's 2 months into this. Keystone Pipeline, gone.
It's like executive
orders. All these executive orders. So people are going to get to really see in very short order just how bad Democrat policies are.
I think most of your people don't realize and won't see it, and they don't understand what the hell you're talking about.
Well, I don't think that's going to last very long. I really don't. I think the influx of people coming into the country is going to burden a lot of cities that don't have the resources to take care of those people.
You cannot just like Cuomo that can hide everything the way he's been doing it.
Yeah. Well, you can't have open borders. You have to have boundaries as a nation and as free individuals. And it just seems to me that every meaningful boundary we have as individuals and as a country, they're always trying to remove any boundary that says we're a sovereign nation, that says America first. They want to completely wipe that out. On an individual level, your right to keep and bear arms, to keep what you earn, to believe in God, to make your own health care decisions, to have privacy. I mean, all of those things, as a nation and as individuals, all of our boundaries are being attacked, which means, in the long run, America was created to be a nation where people were defined as free individuals. Every way defined as free individuals now as being assaulted. By saying it's unfair, by shaming us to take away our boundaries as free people, and it's intentional. You know, I'll tell you a quick story.
It's fear mongering and brainwashing. Well, finest as well.
I had a dentist come to my office. It's about 7 or 8 years ago. She was from Mexico. She had a nice practice going in Mexico. But she had the misfortune of living in a town where the cartel was.
Right.
Okay?
Corruption.
And so she started to notice that people, like, literally started to disappear. And people started to be murdered. And so she looked at the names of the people who had been murdered and disappeared. And she's like, they're killing every well-educated person in the town. And she was a dentist. And she said, I'm on the list. I got to get out. And she actually legally entered the United States to escape being murdered because she knew she was on that list. So here's what we can learn from that. Tyrants are threatened by intelligent people with free speech. You want to know why?
Obviously, you're a racist.
No, I'm not a racist.
We will defend you.
That's the way it is.
Well,
in the United States of America.
Yeah. No, I'm glad you brought that up.
Until the House and the Senate live off the same rules as us,
right. They
should make a little off.
Right. Well, just a little context about me, just so you know. About 8 years ago, I got together with some friends, and I started a nonprofit corporation called The Giving Exchange with some friends. And the whole purpose of it was to help Kenyan orphans. So we shipped libraries, like a library container full of books, for their public schools. We came up with an idea for chicken farms. Chicken farm operation that would cost about $8,000 to build, $1,500 for the first round of chicks, so that they could raise their own chickens, chick to chicken in 7 weeks, so they get protein and they get revenue. And you can put one of those right in the middle of Nairobi at an orphanage, and now instead of just having corn in their diet, they get protein. I love little kids. I don't care what your skin color is. I adore little kids. You know, when you walk through the slums of Nairobi and you see children without running water and electricity and sewage, and you see how hard their lives are, you just want to take them all home. You really do. And so, you know, this past year we shipped a container of musical instruments.
Wow.
Because if you can change the child's image, you can change their destiny. And so one of the concerns I have is all this race rhetoric is causing kids to internalize an identity of resentment rather than love for each other. You know, I mean, God made us all individuals, black, white, Hispanic, Chinese. He's the father of us all. So we have a problem with skin color. I think we got a problem with God, because He made us all unique and different, and He made us all individuals. Like, everybody in this room is different. So if we're all individuals, I think it was always His intention that we be defined and have boundaries as individuals, and that we be free to define ourselves as individuals. That's why we all look different. That's why we all think different and have different, because we're not made to be all the same and fit in some leftist bureaucrats' forced conformity, where, you know, you got to conform to what they want, what they think. You know what?
Did he make male and female?
He sure did.
He
sure did. God made us male and female. He said, honor your mother and father.
Do a hockey populate the earth, and you cannot populate the earth if you are the same gender. You just can't do it. Physically impossible. All in science.
I believe a child needs a mom or a dad.
Desperately.
Okay, cool.
Using these voter machines that are on the internet, and then they're sending the stuff over to Spain and sending it back to tell us how the tally is.
Right.
I don't know about you, but I think there's a lot of smart people that know how to get into the internet and change things.
Well, I spoke to who invented the barcodes would agree with that. That there are security vulnerabilities for the system as it was. I can't speak to whether or not that was absolutely 100% true, but the fact that we didn't look into it, the fact that we all have doubts about the outcome, absolutely mandated that we look into that those issues to find out whether or not they're true and the degree to which they affected the outcome. We don't know. And we should, never again should we have to doubt the outcome of an election. That just shouldn't be permitted. We have to have trust in our process for it to work. Otherwise, when people stop believing in it, they stop participating in it, and then the wrong people with the wrong motives define everything. That's not a path we want to be on.
I want to talk about your current job, not your future job.
Okay.
What can you get done in the next 2 years to shore up our state's rights and shield us from our imperial federal government? Mm.
Okay. Well, actually, there's been some legislation. I think it was introduced in Kansas.
Yeah.
Sanctuary states for Second Amendment rights. I think we should do that. I don't think the federal government, I don't think Joe Biden have a right to take away our right to keep and bear arms. I don't think they have that right. And I think as free states, we need to start asserting our boundaries constitutionally when there is federal government overreach, whatever that unconstitutional encroachment, incursion into our rights in our states. You know, you have to stand up. And that's, you know, whether it's a state or as an individual, you have to stand up for those things. I think there was another state that's doing that as well.
Missouri would be kind of that.
So I think that's a good idea. So last year and this year, we ran a constitutional amendment for the state of Iowa to incorporate the Second Amendment into our state's constitution, where there was strict scrutiny language. Strict scrutiny means that if there's going to be an encroachment on the Second Amendment, you better have a very, very compelling state interest to do that. In other words, we raise the bar really high anytime a state law infringing on Second Amendment rights is ever brought forward. There has to be a very, very compelling, authentic reason to infringe on that. So I support constitutional carry. I believe that when it comes to gun control laws, the only people that obey gun control laws generally are who? Law-abiding citizens. Do you think criminals get too concerned about gun control laws? Go to Chicago. Strictest gun control laws, murder capital of the United States, and they have the strictest gun control laws. How's that working out?
Which is common sense. Why can't people see that? It's common sense. Just like mailing out 100 ballots to, I mean, my Christmas card list, I get mail back, you know, back, person moved. So how in the world could you think you can mail out a million ballots and that's okay? It's like ridiculous. You're going to have to legislate common sense? How can you do that?
So, in response to that question, sometimes ignorance is willful.
Oh my gosh, not yes.
The new law that they're pushing, the Democrats are pushing, is
guilty of a felony because I've already done that.
HR 127.
Neither I had a question there.
If you were to become a U.S. Senator, would you term limit yourself to X amount of years?
I think generally, I think term limits are a good idea. I don't want to give some blanket unequivocal statement that yes, because I think elections kind of serve as term limits. I think term limits, in my view, are the right way to go. But I don't want to be held to say unequivocally down the road. I don't imagine myself being there for more than two terms. I don't. Because I'm 58 years old. I could not see myself wanting to be there past that. But the reason why term limits are a good idea is because people become entrenched. And then when you become entrenched, I think you're vulnerable to corporate special interests that define decisions rather than your constituent base, your middle class base. You know, the whole machinery of getting elected gets stronger and stronger and stronger. And it's usually paid for by corporate interests. And the people that you represent should have an authentic voice. Like you should carry the people that you represent with you into every decision you make. And the question you have to ask yourself is, would I want this done to me? Would I want this done to my children or grandchildren? And so if the answer to that is no, then you have to say no. Even if that gets you in trouble with leadership. You have to be willing to say no to things that violate your conscience. Because if you say yes to things that violate your conscience, you wake up one day, you look in the mirror, and you don't have one. You can't do that. If that answers your question.
Do you know Jeff Johnson?
No.
Lawyer, Sioux City.
There's a lot of them.
Well, several years ago, he fixed up and arranged a contract that the four of us, my siblings, would be buying each year 1% of my mother's farm. And she passed away about 25 years ago. But in that process, when she did pass away, we owned 48% of the farm, and she owned 52%, because she couldn't have control of it, of course. And so that cut down on the amount of taxes that we would have to pay. And that particular format has been used by other people.
It's a good idea.
Yeah. Well, the thing that happened at that time, which is okay, but about 6 months to a year before she did pass, boy, they raised the amount of money that you could, which you would have to pay taxes on. Maybe it went from $1 million to $2 million or $3 million or something like that, which, well, it wasn't okay. It happened, but she still prepared for us to not have to pay taxes, or at least a minimal amount. And that's something that, as far as death taxes are concerned,
right,
people would use that, they're going to get a lot of that tax.
Well, that's the stupid about it, because like 1 year, you can be done with your deal, and then here I am, I'm still 3 years out, and the next year they change it, and then you end up paying nothing.
Yeah, well,
the
yeah.
Next guy, next year, he's
right.
He loses everything.
It changes all the time. I mean,
yeah,
the deduction was $3.5 million. It went to $11 million under President Trump. I think right now it's 11.7 million. And Biden's talking about reducing that number. So what are the realities? Let's say an acre of land's $10,000. Okay, 11.7 million is 1,100.
1,100 acres.
1,100 acres.
Been through it.
So anything you have over and above those 1,100 acres is subject to a 45% or 40% tax, right? So, I mean, you pretty much have to estate plan from the moment your kids are born. You know, and in that conversation is the value of land. Land's probably going to go up another $2,500. If, you know, if prices stay on this trajectory, the value of the land's going to go up, right? Which means the taxes are going to go up. You know, there's a lot of complexities in that.
Yeah.
And the best way is to get rid of the death tax entirely.
If you've been
paying taxes your whole life on every bit of income you got from that land, and then to have 45% of it taxed if you have more than 1,100 acres, that's not fair. That's not fair.
You should be able to get what you have in your hands without having to worry about the government paying in the process. Well, it doesn't work for it and pay for it.
You got 5,000 acres? 45% of those acres after the 1,100 gone. 45%. 3,800 acres are looking at a 45% tax in value, which, you know, unless you have that money set aside, your kids are probably going to have to borrow the money to keep the farm, right? And that's, honestly, I don't know how. There are century farms with all the with all the realities like that to have to deal with, to have to overcome, and to have to plan for and gain for. And, you know, you have to be you have to have your kids buying your land early in the game.
1% every year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I got a number of questions, but I'll start with this one.
Okay.
You seem very knowledgeable about a number of different topics. I first met Chuck Grassley back in 1985, and I was very impressed with him. I got to spend half a day with him, because at that point I was president of the Iowa JCs, and we were having governmental affairs, so you were supposed to meet your reps and senators. Since that time, I've pretty much kept up on his career, and I think he's done actually an admirable job as he is, fighting with the swamp, pushing back, that type of thing, and he seems to continue to have the desire to do that. So my question to you is, I'd like to know your desire, why in God's green earth you want to throw yourself into that swamp. There's a lot of big players on the Republican side, and they're going to put pressure on you, probably pressure that none of us know, and you probably don't even know at this point. So why the desire to throw yourself into that?
In answer to that question, I start every day in prayer, usually for an hour. And I've done a lot of things where I felt impressed to do something, you know, do this, do that. I started that nonprofit corporation that way. Been able to do a lot of good. I ran for the House. I saw a statewide school security protocol for active shooters be created. So every public school in Iowa has one now. Private schools have one now. There's infrastructure there now. I was able to help get that heartbeat bill passed. Within all that, you have to trust that God will put you in a position to do meaningful things. And you have to go forward, whether or not, you know, if you spend your time looking at the mountain all the time, rather than speaking to the mountain, it's how you define yourself that defines ultimately what you do. Are you going to let somebody else define you? Which is what the left always wants to do. They want to pressure you and define you and force conformity on you. Or are you going to stand up for yourself? I started a book club at Fort Dodge Prison. And I went in there, and it's, you know, it's kind of a rough place. was murdered. I wrote legislation for another guy in that situation. So I think the point is, you have to go ultimately with what you believe to be your purpose in life. You have to put your focus on it. You have to associate with it. You have to read about it. And just like a seed in the ground, you have to cultivate the seed of your destiny. And as best you can, bring it to fruition and work at it. Same way you work at getting your crops, you know, every year. And obviously there's a lot more that goes into farming than that. But you have to intentionally cultivate what's in your heart and do it. And don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. You know? Because when you're afraid, somebody else owns you. I'm not good with that. I've never been able to tolerate bullying ever. And I've never been good with anybody trying to push me. And the people down at the House and the Senate at the State House, they know that about me. They know that I don't go along to get along. I didn't go down there to press a green button and do what I'm told. I think about what I do down there. So you have to trust that opportunities and the orchestration of God's plan for your life will make provision for your significance. I think that answers your question.
Thank you.
I think we're, are we good? I know we have another destination in a couple of hours, but.
Yeah, we have some time. I do have some things that everyone wants to sign. We are collecting signatures to get on the ballot.
Just to get on the ballot.
And then also a sheet to stay updated with our campaign events. So I can start to pass those around too.
Well, the other reality is we have to fundraise. So we have a website, carlinforussenate.com. I really appreciate your financial support. I have to deal with that reality. I'm not going to get the support of big corporate entities. My support is going to come at a grassroots level. And I, by the way, I didn't enter this thing to lose. I entered it to win. And I believe I can win. I believe a lot of you guys share my views about this whole process. And in some measure, I hope that you identify with the things that I've said, because this job is about you. It really is. When it's done right, it's about you. It's about your interests. So, yes.
I got one. Well, I'm on a minute, but I've got to ask this one next. With the COVID bill, I call it the Democratic payback or payoff bill. There's just a little, I think you mentioned it, like 1% or 10%. I mean, there's all kinds of numbers been thrown around. What is really for the COVID relief, and all the rest is just bullcrap. But in your experience, how ignorant do these legislators think we are out here that we don't know what's going on? And the dollars that are being spent with this COVID bill, and supposedly everybody has the catchphrase, this is for the Americans, this is going to help our people out. Everybody has that, Republican, Democrat, pundit, whatever. And to me, that is an absolute insult, because we know what's going on. In the end quotient, why in the God's green earth don't they just give us a tax cut and cut regulations? That's what's got to make this thing work. And plus, there's a big pot of money over here that they haven't even spent from the last relief program.
Because that's what Trump did.
Well, I'm just, you know, I'm to the point that I'm just, I'm not going
to you can't
use bad words, but I'm angry. Yeah. I'm angry about this stuff because they're taking my tax dollars and just circulating them back. And I don't maybe get any relief from that. So give me a tax rate and give me a cut in regulations, and I can make a living. Don't think you got to make a living for me. What do we do?
I, you know, it's the hubris of the political class that thinks we don't know stuff like that. They just think we're ignorant of what they're doing. That we don't know that what they're doing is really a tax increase on us all.
And it's Republican or Democrat.
Yeah.
You know, that's so frustrating.
Well, then what you have to do is you have to vote out the people that don't stand up for you, that go along with things like that. When you ask me what you could do, you got to vote them out.
Yeah, I know it's a ballot box, yeah.
It is. It is. You know, on a personal level, I think far too many of us buy into this idea that we're powerless and at the mercy of things. Don't buy into that narrative just because you're told that by all the media platforms, that you're basically powerless and at the mercy. Every single one of us has a voice and a sphere of influence and can do any number of things to push the direction in the right way. We can't, you know, you can't, like I said, you can't let the mountain define you. You have to define the mountain. And you have to individually do everything you can and not be passive about it.
And I agree with that, but, you know, sitting here in this room, we all want to do something.
Right.
But our legislators are still controlling the certain things that we maybe can or cannot do. So sometimes it's like, I don't know, it's just,
Well,
I don't know what to say, but it's just frustrating that,
right.
You know, I hear you're listening to us, and I think you're taking what we're saying here, and you realize where we're at. But so many people of our legislators, we don't see. Shouldn't it be their responsibility to get out and see? We the people that have meetings like what you're at. I know you're running for office, but you understand what I'm saying. And grassmanners, you know, do that. I mean, they can get to all 99 counties, but I've not seen grass. I don't know when he's coming. I don't know when Anderson's coming. And I want to get in front of him just like you and be able to talk to him and say, you're a little kind of bubble in Washington. You know, what you're seeing there isn't happening out here in North America. Come out and talk to us. So how do we get past that?
They come around during the day, during the week, when the people that they should be talking to are working.
And that's what we do out here, right? We work. We work for what we want.
My schedule is not, I don't know when I'm going to be where, so.
When you send emails and you make phone calls, it gets noticed. It does get noticed. I'm not saying it's necessarily going to push somebody one way or another, but I can tell you as a legislator, if I get a gazillion emails about an issue, I don't ignore it. I think about it. I may not always agree with it because some wrong-headed entities are really good about getting their people to send out a gazillion emails. But here's the one thing that I will tell you. The emails that get my notice are not form emails. Because if you send me a form email that 500 other people are sending, I'm not reading it. I'm deleting it. Because I don't have the time to read 500 form emails. But if somebody takes the initiative to write an email in their own verbiage, then those get read, right, Gabe?
They do. So I'm not going through 500 emails, it's the same thing every time.
Same thing every time.
Yeah, and hopefully you're keeping track of those.
Well, we do.
Because that's 500 people that have that opinion.
Yeah, and then you got about 500 from Democrats, you know, yelling at you. So you got to delete all those, too. It's a very fun job.
But they are looked at. And phone calls to operators are noticed. And showing up, you know, I'm sure that if you look at somebody's calendar, their calendar is probably published online, and you know where they're going, so that you can go talk to them and bring your concerns to them. That's what I would do. You know, I think the other thing we really need to be aware of, our kids need to know what's going on. Our children need to know what's going on. They need to know that their freedoms are being threatened. They really do. You know, if you go to a lot of these these public schools now? They are. So they're being indoctrinated. I ran a bill, you want to make a bunch of people mad, I ran a bill that said, let's find out the political composition of our university professors at UNI, Iowa State, and Iowa. They went nuclear when I did that. I said, well, let's look at getting rid of tenure. What did that make them mad? And I said, well, all right. You know, maybe we don't get rid of tenure. Here's what I would like, just so we're sure that people are being disciplined. Give me your last 5 years disciplinary actions and dispositions so I can know if we're getting rid of the bad professors. I'm still waiting. Okay.
That's just
we shouldn't be keeping we shouldn't be keeping professors that are not open to hearing the opinions of their students. The problem is a lot of our students want to get into graduate school, and so if you get in political argument with your professor who doesn't believe he's ever going anywhere no matter what, he can give you a bad grade on an essay and then you don't get into med school. That happens.
Yeah.
Yeah. It happened to a dental student.
The University of Iowa.
At U of I, where he got subjected to a disciplinary action for agreeing with a Trump position. We can't have that. You can't have kids being indoctrinated on college campuses. There has to be meaningful free speech and sharing of ideas. And we need to encourage critical thinking. You know, we used to, in the 60s, they used to say question authority. Well, the young people that go to our universities should be taking a real look at what they're being taught and encouraged to critically think about what they're being taught. How is this going to affect my freedom if I listen to what this guy says? You know, stuff like that.
One day before November 3rd, I got 115 requests for donations to Republican Party people. And when I did that, I deleted them all and said, that's it.
Right.
So how do we prevent that? Because every day, I still get 20 a day.
I get them on my phone, even now. I think you have to do your homework. So one thing I would encourage you to do, if you go to Iowa's legislative website, you can see what I've done. And you can see the bills that I brought forward to locate me, because what you do in that building locates you. So you want to know where somebody stands, you have to do your homework. And if you believe in them, throw some money behind them, because honestly, money is like gasoline in a campaign. You cannot run a campaign without money. I get it, you know, I still get those text messages all the time, and I just delete them. Because I don't know where the money's going. I want to know exactly where the money's going.
All over the money.
Well, I sure appreciate you guys coming out today. You got a good showing here, and this part of Iowa was my introduction to Iowa, and the people that I met in Northwest Iowa were the reason I came here, because this to me is representative of what Iowa is at its best, and I really appreciate that, appreciate you all. And thanks, thank you for listening, and thank you for your questions.
Thank you for coming.
Take a donut for the room.